the fuel on my fire for the knife hobby were the videos done by Jim Skelton.
I knew it. I knew it.
Jim Skelton is the godfather of YouTube knife videos.
Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, episode number 14. I'm Jim, the Knife Newbie Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco from TheKnifeJunkie.com, and we have a great show tonight. We're going to be talking to YouTube's Dr. Frunkey.
Looking forward to it. Want to let you know, though, that today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. You can get a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial. All you have to do is go to audibletrial.com/knifejunkie. Over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, your Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. Again, that address is www.audibletrial.com/knifejunkie.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you've got questions or comments, call the 24/7 Knife Junkie listener line at 724-466-4487.
I'm here with pocket knife connoisseur and high-end knife reviewer, Dr. Frunkey. I've been tuned into Dr. Frunkey on YouTube for about 2 years now and always look forward to his latest video, even though the knives he features are often not to my taste or within my reach. He just always offers insightful, thorough, and well-considered knife talk. And it's my honor to have him on the podcast. Doc, thanks for coming on.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's our pleasure. It's our pleasure. Well, on the Knife Junkie Podcast, we always like to break the ice with a little pocket check. So I'll start with Jim. Jim, what do you have?
You kind of threw me for a loop there, Bob. I thought you were going to start with a doc. But as our listeners know, I carry my little buck canoe, which will probably be put to shame with the knives that you guys have in your pocket. But buck canoe it is for me.
That's why I chose that order, Jim. I didn't want you to have to follow Dr. Frunkey with whatever he's got.
I appreciate that.
I am carrying the new Emerson collaboration ZT knife, the 0640. With this delicious split pea soup carbon fiber. And I put a new MXG gear clip on it because it was audaciously pancake-like and I couldn't fit it in any of my pants.
We could have a whole podcast talking about just that knife.
I know, just the carbon fiber.
Yeah, oh my goodness.
I have fallen in love with this knife. And, you know, I'm an Emerson devotee, at least in terms of his designs. And I love this new knife. Doc, what are you carrying today?
Well, today I was carrying around the Nick Chuprin Robert Carter collab, the new one, the MK1RC. I've been posting about that one on my Instagram a lot recently. Just got it just about a week ago, and I can't put it down.
That has a big, tall kind of tanto blade, right?
Yes, exactly.
With a thumb swale in the back. That is a beautiful, beautiful knife. So, do you carry that in the waistband of your scrubs?
I do. I am I'm a neurosurgery resident physician, and so I go to the hospital every day, and I'm in the OR, and so I wear scrubs every day. And so when I carry a knife, I don't really have it's not easy to put it into the pocket because the pockets on those are so flimsy and they flop around with a 4 or 5 ounce knife.
Right.
I put it on the waistband. Yeah.
Oh, awesome. Okay, that's exactly why I asked, because I know you are a doctor, and I know that, you know, scrubs are kind of like wearing pajamas, so you're carrying a big, heavy knife around. Yeah, it must be in the waistband.
I think that, you know, because of that, my sort of upper limit of acceptable carry weight is somewhere around 6 ounces. Heavier than that, and I'm de-pantsing myself throughout the day. So it's, I think most of my knives are under 6 ounces now.
Well, so how did you get into knives? How did you get to the point where you like knives more than the average person?
Oh, my gosh. How far should we go back here?
As far as you need to.
Well, to be honest, I don't know. It just was a hobby that sort of took over. When I was younger, I got really into cars, kind of like any young guy might do. We learn about cars. We even obsess about them and learn all the details. This was just sort of another extension of a type of hobby like that. I feel like I've told this story before, but the way I got into knives, I bought a knife as a self-defense option, and it sounds stupid, but I had a neighbor that I felt threatened by, and so I purchased a knife because I lived in the city of Chicago where you can't have a gun safely. The laws there are crazy about guns. And so I bought it, and it was silly, and I bought it almost as a gag, but it was a K-bar Tanto, and it was made out of 1095 carbon steel, and, you know, the handle was made out of the rubberized plastic, and I learned about it, and I was like, okay, this is okay, and then I went online, and I was like, is this any good? And it was like, 1095 is kind of, you know, sort of okay if you do it the right way, but maybe not, and then I learned about steels, and it just sort of, it all snowballed in a very sort of engineering and chemistry type of a thing for me. I was a chemistry major in college. And so when I started learning about steels and like handle materials, and people joke of that, I'm sort of a materials guy. Mm-hmm. That was sort of my interest in it. And it just sort of spiraled from there. And I got interested in the designs and the makers and the companies. And I felt like knives were a very achievable hobby. You can get the best, like most ridiculous, craziest knife for $1,000, $1,500, even up to $5,000. I know that sounds like a lot of money, but let's talk about it in relation to other hobbies, guitars, watches, cars, women. Much more expensive hobbies are out there. Exactly. But you can really get to the upper echelons of this at a relatively low cost, even compared to things like guns. You know, it's not even that expensive compared.
Yeah, I discussed that with my brother. My brother's a not a gun guy, but he's got a pretty nice collection, and I like guns. I like it. For me, it's that engineering and materials thing. I like how beautifully fitted everything is, and I like shooting enough. But I have to say, I'm grateful. My obsession has always been knives because it's doable. It's affordable. I can have a chest with 100 knives in it. Can't have a chest with 100 guns in it. It's mm-hmm. just not doable.
And it's also sort of the useful aspect of the knife.
Mm-hmm.
I think that after I got that first K bar, you can't carry a 9-inch K bar around. It's not an EDC knife. And I was like, maybe I could actually use a knife. Got a Spyderco. I think, I don't even know what the first knife that I bought for myself was, maybe either the Spyderco Domino or the Benchmade 940. I feel like mm-hmm. I bought them at the same time.
Right.
And then those are sort of my introduction to high-end pocket knives, to sort of quality pocket knives.
Well, so this interest in knives goes way back for you. How do you think it informed your becoming a surgeon?
Actually, that course was set long before I got into knives. I was on this track before I got into knives. Maybe it sort of augmented my interest because there is an overlap with what I do. I'm training in neurosurgery. We do a lot of brain and spine surgery. I really enjoy spine surgery. And there's a lot of use of metals like titanium. We use 6AL4V titanium
really?
In spine surgery. The rods and screws that go into people's back are 6AL4V titanium.
Only the best.
Only the best. And so there is a crossover, certainly, with what I do every day as my work. I'm certainly cutting. My Instagram description says, my name is Frank. I cut things.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's
because it's on a lot of levels there. That's what I do.
You have a knife. I don't remember what it is now. I think it may be a. I just don't remember. But it has a spinal cord on it, like maybe a hip assembly and a spinal cord or a skull or something. Is that?
That's right. I have a Brown Knife Servo.
Servo.
It was one of the early servos when Craig was trying to sort of show off what he was able to do with his CNC, and he's only gotten better from there. But he did me a huge favor and took my request, and he printed a full anatomically accurate and numerically accurate vertebral column and sacrum. And then he had on the pivot where he normally had his own design, he put a skull for me.
Oh, it's cool.
You know, brain and spine. So it was great.
I like that you stipulated the right amount of vertebra. My father is a radiologist, or was before he retired. And whenever we were watching a movie or TV show, he'd say, that x-ray's backwards and upside down, or whatever whatever it was.
It's a thing. It had to be right. I told him. I was like, we gotta do this the right way.
Oh, yeah. You get laughed out of the ER with the incorrect amount of... So tell people what kind of knives you have in your personal collection, and tell us a little bit about the evolution of your tastes.
Well, I'm happy to talk about that. I went from the Benchmade and the Spyderco. Those were sort of the starting point. I bought a ZT. I was going to get the 562. I ended up getting the 392. the Hinderer limited edition. And you got, if you followed my channel way back then, you know I was obsessed with it at the beginning of my channel. It was like my favorite knife. I was like, this is the best.
Yeah, I remember that.
It just blew me away. It was like really beautiful, really well made, super solid, and again, like achievable. And it felt like I was cool. I had this limited edition. And of course, you know, there's always something better. There's always another knife.
Oh, man.
And you learn this quickly. You're like, okay, you get into Spyderco's, you buy a Delica, you buy a Domino, you buy a paramilitary, you buy a special paramilitary, you buy a Sloosh Buoy. You buy the Nirvana. It's like there's always another level.
And then you send the Nirvana out to Razor's Edge and get it back. And then you really own it.
And then it's really crazy. And to be honest, I can't tell you what really just kept the flame going, but it was so much fun to me. You could tell me what drives you and what made you want to keep going all this time.
I think in the very, very beginning, like in childhood, you know, I'm a little bit older than you, I think. And, you know, growing up in the 70s and 80s, it seemed like every man on TV had a knife on his, you know, Daniel Boone and the Father on Land of the Lost. And, you know, I don't know, I could go on and on, but everyone had a knife. Commando, Arnold Schwarzenegger. If you're a man, you have a knife on you. I think that's kind of where it started.
Crocodile Dundee, that classic scene.
Exactly, exactly. And my grandfather always had the pocket knives, and he would filter them down to my brother and myself once they were too old for him to use. But what keeps me there, you know, you said before, it sounds funny to buy a knife for self-defense. Well, you're talking to the right guy here, because, you know, I've done, I consider knives for self-defense all the time. That's how I started carrying them, actually. Also, I lived in New York City, and it was kind of a similar situation.
Yeah.
But just, I don't know. It's the look. I mean, I look at the lights on the back of an Audi, and I'm like, wow, that looks like a Warncliffe. You know, I look at the lines on the road, you know, as I come up to them. Oh, that makes a perfect Bowie shape. You know, I don't know. I just see them everywhere, and I like, and now, you know, and I've always been an artist, and now I'm making them. So I feel like the commitment level has shifted even.
Well, I hear you. I think once you kind of get pet, and I'm glad you brought up sort of the art of a knife, because that's certainly at these higher levels, and certainly where my collection is right now, it's certainly approaching more of an artistic expression, more so than I'm just collecting a bunch of tools.
Right.
So I certainly enjoy knives at their foundation because they're also a tool. I really think that humans do a very poor job of cutting things with our soft, soft hands.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a helpful tool to have, whether it's tiny or big. You know, you don't need a 3.5-inch knife every day. You know, you can get around with a tiny little nothing blade. But
if you're a sissy,
but you know, you choose to have these things.
Yeah.
At this point in my collection, I am collecting knives that are made of very interesting materials, but at their foundation are still excellent tools, because I carry all my knives. I have a Peter Rosenti Nirvana. We talked about the Spyderco version. I bought that one, and then I had to get the custom version.
Yeah.
So I have that. And I've gotten into Robert Carter knives recently. I have a Talon that I carried a couple of days ago. Custom Tech. I'm looking at my case right now.
Right.
Just going down the line. I have a Jason Guthrie Scout. I have a Gareth Bull Shamwari.
Oh, yeah.
Jonas Iglesias Volt. And a few others. I have an Andre Thorburn L36M that's coming back to me pretty soon.
So your collection has some really high end knives, and you've gone from the Spydercos and Benchmades up to there. My high end knives are like Hinderers and you know, ZTs and Microtechs and that kind of thing. And it's a sort of progressive insanity. Like you said, there's always another knife in the offing. And you're a materials guy. What material is drawing you on right now? What material is pulling you to different knives?
Well, I want to comment on what you said about the progression. If you want to, there is a video documentation of my progression on YouTube. If you go back to my original video, I have the first video I ever made was Spyderco Nirvana. This, and then like the regular Nirvana, and then I made one about my 392. That was all the way back to the very beginning of my real sort of interest in knives. And then from there, it springboarded, and it's just gone and gone and gone. And so now I have a fascination with some of these mixed metals, like Mokutai, Timascus. I have a lot of Mokume There are a lot of different new types of mokume coming out.
What's mokume again?
So mokume is a shortened form of the word mokumegane, which is a Japanese word for looks like wood, right? Something like that.
Okay.
Has the appearance of wood. Mm-hmm. And what that means is it's actually precious metals, or just metals that are shiny metals that are combined in such a way, forge welded, pattern welded in such a way that they form, you know, beautiful patterns. So you have like copper, brass, or copper, bronze, and zirconium, copper, bronze, and nickel, silver, or some combination of these things. And there are even more precious versions of this. There's like an entity called Jewelers Mokume that's not really talked about much. That's all the precious metals you can think of. And it's beautiful stuff. It's just very pretty.
So I have not laid my hands on a knife that has mokume, for instance, or the, what you were describing. Are these materials as tough as, say, titanium, or as robust as steel? They look beautiful, and that's what, you know, they almost look like glass sometimes to me, like swirled Tiffany glass or something like that. Are these materials tough?
Well, it depends on who's making them. Certainly, if you're getting it from some guy, you know, off the back of his truck, maybe not. I mean, anyone can try to stick two different types of titanium into an oven and see if they weld together.
Right.
But, you know, there are some people out there, and they have become successful at it. Chad Nichols, Robert Carter, you know, the guys at Alpha Knife Supply, who make these materials, and they're very strong. So it's really just titanium and titanium alloys that are fully, you know, welded together solidly. And they have perfected their craft. And so if something were to happen, it would be something called a delamination, where these things come apart.
Right.
And you'd be able to tell that very quickly. They've basically worked that out of their system, as far as I know. And it's very strong.
So by the time it gets to the knife maker, the delaminations and all that stuff, that's already eliminated out of the process.
Ideally, I'm sure that there are snafus here and there, because it's sort of an imperfect science, but it's fascinating to me, because so much time and effort goes into these things. Someone has to get these materials, raw materials, and form it into this artistic pattern. And then somebody else has to form it into a knife. And so just a huge amount of time and energy and thought and soul, I'll call it, goes into something like that.
And yet it's still, you know, when it gets to your pocket, it's still a tool. It's not a work of art. It's a work of design that's done with great artistic flair, which is what appeals to me. It's the knifeness of it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that there is an extreme. I think that recently I've been exploring that extreme, and people have been giving me some flack about it, but it's fun, though. It's just so much fun to have to do this. It's crazy.
People are giving you flack because they have so many interesting things going on in their life that they have to worry about where your knife tastes are veering.
Oh, my gosh. It's so crazy, isn't it?
Well, speaking of YouTube, how do you think YouTube has affected the knife world in the last 10 years?
Oh, well, I think that with the advent of social media and cell phones in particular, that video media is, you know, an excellent way to get a message out there. And I don't know, to be honest, I got it. The fuel on my fire for the knife hobby were the videos done by Jim Skelton.
I knew it.
Jim Skelton is the godfather of YouTube knife videos. Like a nothing fancy, kinda. Nothing fancy, like he made some okay videos like 5 or 10 years ago, but then he went completely insane. And you know,
He's like the cool old grandpa. Yeah. But Skelton is man. He's another one that I can watch his videos, even though I know I'm never ever gonna lay my hands on that thing. It's just and he shoots them beautifully. I find your videos very well shot, very well lit.
I appreciate that. I really and I gotta give him a ton of credit. I really emulated his style. I don't want to say I copied it, because I can't copy his style. But you know, I have a lot of those elements because it just worked so well, and it's what I wanted to do too. So I really owe him a ton of credit for that.
And your tastes are somewhat concurrent too. I feel he's always, and I don't know if you've seen the knives he's making. He's making beautiful knives now.
Yeah, well, I mean, you asked me, has YouTube affected the knife community? He showed me the knives that he thought were cool, and so I thought they were cool, and so now there are, you know, from there were 10 knife channels before, now there's 100, and you know, there it's, it's hard to keep track of them all, and they're all great. And the voices out there are helping people to understand what's good and what's not so good. So I definitely think it's been a good thing for the community.
Yeah, I kind of feel like there wasn't even a community before, but I don't know. I wasn't tapped in to the community before YouTube, but I feel like, yeah, that's what, I mean, for me, it's almost pornographic watching someone manipulate a knife. And after a while and hearing it and watching it, you're like, damn, I better just get that knife, you know, or conversely, no way. I could hear how that sounded when it closed. And it's just not the knife for me.
It definitely helps to see it on the screen and see somebody talk about it.
So what's your process for producing videos, for coming up with the content and what knives you're going to get next? How do you work your channel?
Well, in the beginning, it was a handful of knives that I happened to own and a couple of knives that my buddy had. And after I was able to churn out maybe 20 videos with the knives that I had immediately available, I reached out to a friend of mine. His name is Nico. He's appeared a few times on my channel.
Yeah, you've mentioned him often.
Yeah, well, he is a good friend of mine. We went to college together, and he, at the same time as I, got into the knife hobby just randomly, and we somehow linked up on Facebook because I posted some random picture one day early before I was really on Instagram about a knife, and we reconnected about it. Anyways, he started buying knives. He has a lot more money than I do, and he started buying knives, and he lives in Greece, so he would have them shipped to me, and I would send them to him, and so I was getting some of those for a while, and I started buying some of my own, and then I generated some viewership and some subscribers and people in this community, I must say, like you too, tonight offering to have me on this show, are extremely generous.
I have found that too. Yeah.
People reached out and they said, hey man, I like your style. How about you check this out? I will say one of the most influential people in this community silently is a guy that goes by the name of Tony Meter. You've probably seen him posting all over the place. That guy has maybe not.
Maybe, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. He is one of the silent movers and shakers. I got to give a lot of credit. Tony Meter, Tony.meador, a genuinely kind soul. He has single-handedly supported the channels of myself, Eugene Kwan, JT's Knife Life, and various others by having an excellent collection himself, a large production knife collection, and sending them out to all of us so that we could check these things out. We were able to establish that, and then a couple other guys, and then I started pouring more and more money into it and getting my own knives. In terms of the process, I wish I had one. I really do. It's I think Nick Shabazz has got like this extremely scientific process.
He's a scientist, right?
He sits down and he writes the scripts and he's got notes and he's got pictures and he's got 150 videos that are backlogged right now. Exactly. And I'm like, I'm just trying to squeak by. I just find things that I find interesting. And then the thing that motivates me to make a video is, do I find a knife interesting? And do I want to share that with the community, whether good, bad, or indifferent? I think that there are certain knives that are destined to be good, and I want to check them out and tell people whether or not I feel they're good and have them make their own decisions by being as objective as I can be. And then just chronicle my own collection, just show people, like what Jim Skelton did. I think Jim Skelton had a vision for his knife collection. He showed that on his channel, and our visions are, similar but different. And I like sharing that too, because I think it inspires other people to find their sort of interest as well.
And then you always, you put yourself out there and you're bound to run into some Mama Lukes who are just going to try and make life miserable for you. I mean, so as pocket knife lovers, are we going too hard when we start writing nasty comments to YouTubers such as yourself about your taste in pocket knives, or also at the same time? I mean, well, let me just ask you that. Comments and such.
I welcome opposing points of view. I think that my videos are very subjective. I think reviews in general are subjective things, because what's good for me may not be good for somebody else. What I perceive as good may not be the same as somebody else. I'm simply giving my opinion. I appreciate when someone is able to express an opposing view in a kind and gentlemanly way.
Yes.
Some people go into the, you're an idiot, you know, you have no idea what you're talking about, you know, just kind of ranting and berating me. And then certainly picking on somebody's personal taste is just kind of also silly. But I think it's also difficult because it's a community predominantly of males. And it's like you were mentioning, it's weapons. And so sort of an era of sort of masculinity and machismo. We're all flexing sometimes about this. So
can't imagine something less macho than sitting in your basement and bitching to someone, taking all that time to write someone a negative comment.
Yeah. And, you know, I try not to be negative in my reviews. I don't try to make negative reviews. I feel like I've done a few, but I do them only to try to help people so that they don't waste their money.
I have noticed that you and there are a couple of exceptions to that that stand in sharp relief in my mind. So what kind of customer interaction do you expect from, you know, if you're shelling out a lot of money for a custom knife, the maker's commitment to you is different than Cold Steel's commitment to me when I buy a broken skull or something like that.
Yes.
What kind of customer interaction do you expect?
Well, that's an interesting question because I think that depends on how you come to acquire the knife. I think that Instagram is a very powerful tool for the knife collecting hobby, the custom knife collecting hobby. I predominantly communicate with most of the makers that I've ever got anything from through Instagram. What I expect if that's how I initiate contact is a regular update with regards to the knife status. I do not push people to make them quickly. Because a successful maker, a good maker, has a lot of knives to make and is busy and needs to work at their own pace. And so, but I do appreciate it when they say anything from, I can't get to it this week, I can't get to it this month, I can't get to it this year, but I'm going to make it at some point. Even that is fine. But certainly, if the process is going, I like to have some communication. Work in progress pictures are the best.
Oh,
videos
cool.
are the best. And then an open discussion about making changes and discussions about, you know, what's possible. I really like to push some makers who are willing to do what is the maximum possible for them. I'm like, go to town, do the most, have fun, try it out.
Right.
And that's the most fun. I enjoy that.
So basically you're saying some of the greatest results come from experiments or come from taking chances. And you might end up with a one of a kind or a first of the kind knife from that maker, from giving them that freedom, that creative freedom.
Well, I'll tell you, when I got the Talon, I told Rob, you know, go crazy, do something special. When I got the Scout, I said, you know, make it the most Jason Guthrie Scout that's ever been made. And he put the dimples in it and it's got all the bells and whistles. And it's just, it is a lot of fun. I enjoy that. And then when you get a good interaction with a maker where they're friendly, they genuinely enjoy what they're doing and they're happy to share it with you and then happy to sell it to you. That's the best. That's what I enjoy.
So for you personally, where do you see your knife hobby going, as you age?
I'm honestly a little bit worried because in a couple of years, I'm going to start making more money than I'm making right now.
Right.
And I think it's going to accelerate things significantly. So I'm going to have to figure out how that's going
to
go.
You're going to have to get a wife or two to kind of like cut that.
Yeah, I'm not currently married. So I do, you know, that's how I afford this. I don't have a wife and kids. You know, I think that I should just put that out there. This probably wouldn't be possible. This is a rather selfish endeavor at times. And if it comes to that point, my hobby may change. But for now, I don't see much slowdown coming. I think that my video volume will probably go down, just to be honest, because it's very hard to maintain that volume. And I think that my videos on some knives, like production knives, might kind of be lost in the wind sometimes. Just there are so many opinions. And so I feel like my videos and my collection will continue sort of down the path of my tastes. And I just want to continue to be, you know, myself.
I think you have a real niche there, and I think you're wise to stick with it. There are a million guys just like me putting up videos of their ZTs, but there aren't too many people who are collecting these beautiful high-end pieces from these knife makers and, frankly, keeping them in business. You know, that you're like a patron in a way, and I think that that's really great. And at some point in my, you know, knife collecting, I would like to offload some of the stuff I have and start turning them into knives with more soul, you know, as you put it, knives that are handmade. And I just haven't gotten there yet.
And I think what I will end up doing is more information on how to make that happen. Maybe more discussion videos, more things like that, philosophical things, maybe.
I think people have an appetite for that kind of discussion.
I really think that's what made Nick Shabazz so successful. I think he doesn't just make knife videos, right? He makes philosophical videos, deep videos, and like meaningful things and honest discussion. And I think that, again, he's just one man with one opinion, and he says that himself. And I think that there should be opposing views or similar views and other discussion like that. And I think I'd like to do more of that this year.
So a couple more things. One, I want to urge you to get a Tough Knives, a Jeff Blauvelt for me, because I follow him on Instagram, and every knife he makes is more outstandingly gorgeous than the one before it. I mean, he's unbelievable, that guy.
You know, I have to say, his knives have certainly evolved, and they are, I agree with you, completely breathtakingly beautiful now. He's got a style all his own. I feel like he's evolved even in the last, you know, 6 months.
Yeah.
He sort of has adopted a new style, and it's really amazing. And if I only had all the money in the world, yeah, I would definitely do it.
So before we get to a little speed round of questions, I want to ask you, do you have a stupid knife story? I've been asking this question. I have so many of them. I'll break the ice with one of them.
Oh, yeah.
This is about 15 years ago, and I'm living in a hipster loft in Brooklyn. And the people down the hall are having a party, and I fancy one of the girls there. So I'm, you know, put on my best duds. I go over there, and we're hanging out at the party. And I'm at the height of my martial arts powers at the time, and, you know, training sword stuff all the time. And someone busts out a sword cane. I'm like, okay, everyone clear a circle. And I start doing some knife stuff, showing off, because I'm a little bit drunk. And, I stab myself in the calf about 3 inches deep.
Oh,
everyone shut up and looked at me, and I slowly walked out and down the hall and didn't go back to the party. I returned the sword and cane the next day. Stupid knife story too.
Well, dang, that sounds painful. Mine wasn't so physically painful, maybe, as it was emotionally painful. I took a trip to New York City, and I thought it would be a great idea to bring some knives with me in my checked bag. And I did. And I got there, and it was great. And on a beautiful sunny day, I was walking around the city of New York with my beautiful custom Peter Rosenti Nirvana.
Mm.
Beautiful knife, unbelievable fit and finish, integral handle, gorgeous thing. Well, it came to the point in the day where it was time for us to go to the Statue of Liberty. We were just on that side of the island, and we were like, okay, well, we can do this. It's an option. It's here. Let's do it. And they were like, no knives. It's like an airport security checkpoint. You can't go to the island with anything resembling a knife. And so I, in my idiocy, stashed this thing somewhere where I thought it would be when I got back. And then I came back, and it most certainly wasn't there.
Oh.
Gone were the $1,200 and the most beautiful knife in my collection at the time. And so that was pretty crushing. That was my stupid knife story. Don't do that. Don't go to the statue. Just get some binoculars and look at the statue, because yeah, it just gets bigger, and that's it. And then it goes and it gets smaller again.
You can get even closer on your iPad. So
that's
yeah,
right. That's right.
That just hurt my heart. That just made me want to vomit.
Well, luckily I was able to get another one, and so all is right in the world. But man, oh man, that was a painful thing.
Well, you have to imagine it's just some dude walking around with this unbelievable knife. He has no idea. He has it thrown in his glove box of his truck right now. I shouldn't be saying that. That's really mean and nasty. I shouldn't say that.
I genuinely hope that some New York police officer got that knife and has it and is using it as a shovel. Like, as long as it's not in the dump, I just hope it's not in the garbage somewhere. Yeah. That'd be the worst.
All right. So, Doc, I want to do I want to ask you 15 questions. You're going to give me a one word answer.
I'll do my best.
Okay. Fixed or folder?
folder.
Front flipper or thumb stud?
Ooh, that's a tough one. I'm going to say thumb stud.
Washers or bearings?
Depends on the maker. Bearings.
Okay. Tanto or Bowie?
Bowie.
Hollow or flat ground?
Hollow.
Full size or small?
Full size.
Gentleman's knife or tactical knife?
Gentleman's knife.
Okay, this is special for you. Robert Carter or Peter Rezenti?
I hate you so much right now. That's the meanest thing you've ever done. I'm going to have to say Rob Carter right now. We have a good relationship going right now. He's an awesome guy and just a huge fan of him and his work right now. So I'll say Rob. No offense to Peter, but this is the way things are right now.
Well, that was a prudent move. ZT or Wii?
ZT.
Benchmade or Spyderco?
Spyderco.
Cold steel or CRKT?
Oh, I've never owned a cold steel knife. See, I have to say CRKT because I've never owned a cold steel.
All right. Carbon fiber or micarta?
Carbon fiber.
Finger choil or no?
Finger choil.
Form or function?
Function.
And finally, your desert island knife. Right now, from your collection, one knife that you use for the rest of your life.
Ooh, one knife forever and ever?
Yeah.
One knife to rule them all. I have to go with the Peter Rezenti Nirvana. I know I just said Rob Carter, but the Nirvana is the most perfect knife to me.
Oh, God. That is such a beautiful knife. I really admire that knife. Every time I see it, I want it more.
Well, thank you.
But it will have to wait.
One day.
Visit the Knife Junkie online at theknifejunkie.com.
Dr. Frunkey, I want to thank you for coming on the Knife Junkie podcast. It's been awesome to get to know you a little bit and to chat with you. Your videos are inspirational to me, and they're just fun to watch. And another thing, I appreciate the intelligence that goes into it. I don't know how else to put it. Like when you talk, I listen. So thank you so much for coming on the show. Is there any place you want to tell people to find you other than YouTube?
Well, let me just say thank you very much. I'm humbled that anyone watches my videos, much less somebody would feel inspired to continue this trend of sharing the information about the community. So I commend you for doing that as well, because the more of us there are, the better decision-making people will be able to do out there. So awesome. You can find me. I've talked about myself this whole podcast. I feel very selfish, but you can find me on YouTube as Dr. Frunkey, Frunkey, and the same name on Instagram. I'm also have a podcast of my own called the Knife Life Podcast with a few other members of the community. So feel free to give us a listen on that. And really appreciate the work you guys are doing here. And I look forward to more conversations.
Yeah, me too. It's been a pleasure. Everybody, thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast, and we'll check you out next week.
Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. You can get a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial. All you have to do is go to audibletrial.com/knifejunkie. Over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, your Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. Again, that address is www.audibletrial.com/knifejunkie.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, theknifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on theknifejunkie.com/Instagram and join our Facebook group at theknifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to bob@theknifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.